out there telling them any different. Our messages that are coming across Facebook, YouTube, all that, aren't preaching the true gospel. Like, you know, I'm talking about the body of Christ as a whole. I'm not talking about this place, but I know we do. And I know Pastor Walter and Pastor Ralph. I'm just saying, that's what we're up against. We are a few that we got a big work to do. The thing that we need to do is we got to fix the heart of the pastors and the teachers, especially ones that's leaving the pulpit. We got to minister to them and get them back on point. It begins here.
Yes.
I'm going to get to the lights. You can be a lighthouse. Serve as a navigational system. It guides the ships and stuff. Everybody can't be the same light. Everybody got their own gift. You can be a lighthouse. And I'm not saying that God can't call you to be a lighthouse one day and a light bulb the next. That's how God works. You got to allow the Holy Spirit to move you in whatever way that he chooses to move you.
Amen.
When you allow him to move and order your steps, that's how you'll be able to step off a bus like I did. And he would give me the morning of my eyes would wake up. He'd say, go do this. Go do that. And that's how that meal would come that day. That's how that bill would come that day. That's how this would come. Now, the rent still ain't paid. And I'm like, Lord, okay. I'm listening for that one. He showed me a house. Not to say that I'm not going to pay the rent. But he said, this is where you're going. We're done with this one. So I started packing and moving. I know he's going to give me my cup. That's what I'm going to say. You can't shine if you're in debt.
That's right. That's right.
You got to clear out your own debts first. Be debt-free as possible. As soon as possible. Because you cannot help somebody and you are drowning yourself.
That's true.
So, always, and that's mm-hmm. goes with honoring your word. If you go out there and borrow, pay it back. Make sure you pay it back. If you got debts on your credit report, clear it up. The statistics, I wish I'd brought it with me. Statistics say that Christians, we have the most debt. Because we believe in God to fix it. We just going out there using credit. God teaches you common sense.
Yes, he does.
So, if you got debt on your credit, he ain't trying to get you to go out there and do a ministry. He's trying to get you to fix your own credit first. You got to be an example first before you can be an example of somebody else.
That's right.
Amen. I can't tell you credit repair if my credit wasn't fixed.
Yes.
And then, when your credit's fixed, you can't hoard it. He going to use that, too, to bless somebody else.
Right.
And I'm like, my heart smiles so big, you know, because I'm like, Lord, I got me a new car. Thank you, Jesus. I'm able to have somebody else get a new car. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Your heart just smiles.
Yes.
It is a blessing to be a gift. Just last year, I wasn't able to do that. I was in so much debt. I was so miserable. I felt like, how am I supposed to give? I can't even give myself. And he started to show me. Credit was there. Started to get my own stuff together. Yeah. So that's how you begin to be a light. You got to fix your life first. That living water, that crying, and everything that the Holy Spirit do, that's fixing you. The emotions, the repressed anger. Maybe, like I was sent to a lesson for 16 years of my life. If God hadn't fixed that, I couldn't stand up here and talk to you. I couldn't talk to them girls on the bus that be coming on there twerking with their dresses halfway. If they see, you can see all their business. I couldn't be able to talk to them. Because, you know, the devil comes to put something in your life to suppress your spirit so much to the point where you feel like you can't do nothing. And if he got you under his wing, he ain't got to worry about you.
Yeah, that's right.
If the devil is on you in your life, consider that God may have something for you to do that's so big that the devil is trying to keep you from it.
Amen. That's true.
Get up and get in your word.
Amen.
I'm just saying, make a date with God. God is my best husband. Make a date with him.
Yes.
Just make a date with him. Spend time. I love having my consecration Saturday. Ooh, I kick the kids out of everything. I have the house to myself. It's just me and God. I'll be in my Bible most of the time, 5 o'clock in the morning. Next thing you know, it's 8 o'clock. They coming in. I've been in that word all day and ain't even seen it turn from day to night. That's just my consecration with God. That's a love affair that I wish everybody had. That's what I'm saying. That's what's keeping me from getting a husband, because I'm like, who he gonna take that from me? You know, he gonna steal the covers, you know, stuff like that. But I'm very picky of even who I entertain, because I don't want to give no false, you know, witness or anything. The man, he got to know Jesus.
Amen.
He got to. If he don't know Jesus, he don't even get a day. He don't even get a lunch day. And we started with lunch. We ain't going with dinner because, you know, things happen. We ain't going with that. Well, actually, we started with breakfast. With breakfast. I mean, when he getting up, I don't want him to think nothing going to happen. With breakfast. Then we take it to lunch. If it makes it to lunch, then he, okay, the lunch, okay, maybe I'll introduce him to my kids. I don't, my kids only know one person. That's, I call him my best friend. He's 62 years old. He's a bass player at the Isaac Hayes. That's the only man they ever know for me. You know, as far as friend or being, you don't want to talk to or whatever. But we talked the Bible. He taught me about Constantine, and he taught me back about back days back then. So we talk Bible.
Amen.
I don't have different men running in and out of my house and stuff like that. So I'm saying that to say, when you in love with God, you ain't got room for nothing else.
That's right.
You just in love with God.
Amen.
I'm a lighthouse to the children on that bus.
Yes.
I'm leading them to the kingdom that they're supposed to be in. I'm leading them to the kingdom of God. They don't believe God. They think God is a fairy tale. They think it costs too much to go to church. Because you got churches that are having revivals, which I do believe. I want us to have a revival. I see it. Mm-hmm. A revival. But these revivals that they have them coming there in the first of 500. Jesus ain't never did that. T.D. Jakes and them, they talk about them big mega churches, but all they do is set something on the thing. Then people just come throw their offering. When you know to do good, you do good. You ain't got to prompt and pull nobody to give no money.
That's right.
If you're feeding their need, if you're meeting them where they at, Jesus going to move in their heart and they're going to give on their own.
Yes,
he is. Bible study. I do Bible study every Wednesday night at 7 o'clock at my house. And we don't prompt and pull. Brianna just puts a little bucket down there. They know if they happen to give that. I don't make people feel bad because they don't happen to give. Because I know God is going to supply my needs anyway.
Yes, he is.
Even taking care of me before I ever met anybody. So you don't prompt and pull out of nobody.
That's right.
And to give out an obligation, you ain't supposed to give anyway, because God said that he need a cheerful gift.
Yes.
You give, if you don't give cheerfully, you ain't going to get no return on it anyway.
Right.
If they making you feel obligated to give, then you might as well keep that in your pocket.
Amen.
There's a lot of ministries out there that do that. And they supplement their income.
Yes.
There's a lot of pastors, teachers, preachers that's going to jail doing stuff like that. Taking grants and everything. And, you know, going to uplift their lifestyle. And they ain't fed not one homeless. Mm. Now, when I was on the bus, you know, going through, coming out of my situation, the ministry that they have with the peanut butter and the chips and stuff that Millie has, I used to feel bad about taking that. But then God said, if you're not eating, I can't use you.
Amen.
Yeah. So I would take that and I would save mine and be transparent. I would save mine for Monday morning, when, because I was out there at the RVO yard and I didn't have enough gas to get back and forth every day home and be able to go to work. So I would spend my time in the car, in the back seat of my car, with my peanut butter sandwich, my chips, and my drink.
Yeah.
That was my lunch for that Monday. And I would be back there with my word. I call and check on my kids. That's why all my kids have a cell phone, so they can get to me. I don't have a cell phone for my kids so I can sit up with them. I have a cell phone so they can get to me, because that means they're going to be away from me, not sitting with me. There's a lot of parents that pay for cell phones and they right there with them. What's the purpose? You're wasting money.
That's right.
The cell phone is for them to get you in the event of a problem. When they was having all the big things about the police officers. Now, I'm not against the police officers. I know it's the spirit of the devil that's got confusion and stuff going.
Yes.
But just to calm my spirit, my son, when he would come home from the culinary academy, on Sunday, he would turn on Facebook Live, and I would watch my son walk home on Facebook Live. I would see, because we live in a neighborhood that's not too good. We call it hood. But you know, the hood need Jesus too.
Amen.
So I live in a neighborhood where my ministry, or God's ministry, is able to prosper. That's why the house that he showed me is still in that neighborhood. It's a big, beautiful house, but it's still in that neighborhood. I'm comfortable with being where my purpose is.
Yes.
I don't drive that bus for a paycheck. I drive it because of my purpose. That's how I'm able to go to that job every day, do what I'm supposed to do, and not feel bad, because I'm living off purpose. Live off purpose. Don't live off paycheck.
Yeah.
Live off purpose. If what you're doing is not making you or allowing you to feel like you're getting anything out of life, maybe you ain't operating in purpose. Operating in purpose. That's what I was teaching that one day, operating in purpose. The next light you could be is a fluorescent light. Now, this is a catch-22 because a fluorescent light is a bright light. It helps you see and everything, but a lot of people don't know that there's a hidden agenda behind that light. The gases and stuff that it emits and everything, it hurts your eyes. And it does something to your skin complexion, too, if you sit by a light with a fluorescent. You know, look it up, Google it, study it. See, I'm a scientist. I love all that. So I don't have too many. I get the glow, the other lights or whatever. But, you know, they're a little softer. But fluorescent lights I use outside because we ain't out there too much. You could be a light bulb, a regular light bulb. It's an electrolyte device that produces visible light by flow of electricity. That means something natural, God, something natural coming. You could be just a regular light bulb to somebody, an idea, something of that nature. A floodlight is a wide, broad beam light. It intensifies everything. Do you know that's an artificial light? That light ain't even real. It's made out of sodium vapor. But it expands. It shows everything. If you are a floodlight, you may be pounding your own drum. You may be flooding the people out. When people look into a floodlight, they can't see. They got to close their eyes. Sometimes you have to be a floodlight to get people's attention. But then you've got a downside so they be able to take what you got to say. There's a nightlight. It reminds me of the children of Israel when God was coming through, put the blood on the doorpost. They said put a light in there that when he would pass by and everything, the blood too. He said it illuminates the way to see at night. I sleep with my light on my stove because it deters pests. Turn the light on, roaches scatter. You know, if you live in that type of environment, you turn the light on, you know that. I seen that one day on TV. I've been living with light ever since. Because it keeps the pests down. It keeps the insects down. In scripture, that's like it keeps the foul spirits out.
Amen.
They don't like the light. Jesus is the light of the world. You always got to keep a night light on.
Yes.
So the next light is a black light. This light is an ultraviolet light. And it's not much visible light, but it's used to trap the insects. It's just enough light to where they think it's still dark, but you come through. And they get to see. And then you get to trap them in whatever mechanism you have. And the last light is my favorite light. It's the light I believe we're supposed to be. Because he said, a candle is put on the candlestick as a candle. A candlelight may be small in one, but you ever seen a number of them? Like a vigil? You ever seen all those candlelights? Those one single little candlelight glow everywhere. They just glow. And then I like a candlelight too, is because it illuminates the room. That one little candle. If we turned all the lights in here at dark, you know, that one little candle will illuminate the room. It would be like a night light too,
yes.
But it illuminates the room. But the most important thing that I like about a candlelight is because when our friend or our member is going through something and maybe their light has been put out, we can take a little bit of our light and put it on they and relight them.
Yes.
Amen.
That's the only light that can relight another person.
Yes.
So that's the type of light that I like to be. Anytime I bring a message, I ain't trying to bring a message to bombard nobody's head or whatever, you know, when God say you gotta tell it, you gotta tell it. But I'm just saying I like to bring messages that encourage and uplift.
Yes.
Not hellfire damnation, because people don't know what hellfire damnation is. You just run it like, okay, what are we supposed to do with that? Let us all be the light. Let us all be a candlelight. It starts in here before we go out there.
Yes.
Like I said, I felt bad taking the sandwiches and everything. But as I'm back to work tomorrow, y'all know, I'll take my sandwiches, I'm going to give it to somebody else. Because if you got food in your house, be a blessing.
Amen.
Don't just take it for
yourself.
Yeah. Take your blessing that was given to you and pass it on. I always say, give it forward. But I'm saying, it starts in here. Don't let somebody in here be in need and we just walk by them.
Yes.
We supposed to know the need of the people in
That's
here.
Right.
We supposed to be in fellowship.
Yes.
Like I said, always, we supposed to go to God, the source, but always Don't be so prideful that you can't let nobody know they need, know you need. I preach my need. I say, you know, I'm all, you know, whatever. That way, God lays it on anybody's heart to do this. That's why people came and said, I don't have the money, but I got this on that bill. God kept my house going through people filling my need.
Amen.
He kept, I'm still standing. Roof still over my head. Yes. Still yes. driving a car. Yes. And I had no income for the last 3 months. Yes. Only Jesus. And that's how he does it. The windows yes. of heaven are the hands. Yes. We need to be the hands, the windows of heaven. Yes. We need to help others. Don't, I'm hungry. Don't just walk by somebody. I walked outside one day and I was just talking. I said, I'm hungry. Mother Mary said, okay, you're hungry, let's go. We went to the buffet.
Amen.
That's just the heart of God right there. All I did was say, I'm hungry. She said, okay, we going. She took the whole people to the buffet. We went to Fiesta. We fellowship, had a good old time. And people think we crazy for being allowed. We just be talking Jesus every day. Don't let Pastor Walter get started. His voice just carries. But we have fun. We hang out a lot all the time. But I'm saying, we know each other. We have a need. That's why I say I try to get used to everybody. If I see a need or hear a need and I have it, and I'm like, okay, Lord. Like she needed yarn. I just didn't know where it come from, why I was there, but I had this whole bunch of yarn in my living closet. I need yarn to do this, to do the Jesus cross, everything. I went in there, grabbed it, and I put it in a bag and gave it to her. I said, there you go. That's how Jesus worked.
Amen.
He gives you something right. that you may not even know what you're supposed to do with it, but hang on to it because he's going to send you somebody that's going to need it.
Yes.
And you got to be able to get it through you. God gives us blessings. He don't give them to us. He give them to get it through us.
Amen.
Yes. Nonprofits, we're not supposed to own nothing because nonprofit belongs to the organization.
Yes.
It's the organization. Everything that belongs to the organization belongs to the people. He just giving it to us to get it through us. We ain't supposed to hoard, like, you know, EOB with the cell phones and all that. So I have a nonprofit. I'm learning about nonprofit. And now as he's starting to give stuff in, I say, okay, this goes here, this goes there. You know, it's just through. And he blesses us as we get it through. We start hoarding and taking for ourselves. You ain't going to get it no more. You're going to dry up. You won't have no growth.
That's right.
So I'm saying, I'm going to close. Be a candlelight. At most times, be a candlelight. You know, you have to say, you need to be a lighthouse or something, like I need to be the children all night, like all that. But most times, be a candlelight. Because a candlelight can see somebody going through something. And be discerning of the spirit. Know whether the tears are joy or whether the tears are somebody's hurting.
Yes.
Be able to talk to that person. And you ain't got to make a big scene when you give it to them.
That's right.
Give it to them in secret. Because some people don't want all that. You run people off like that.
True.
Like, it was a few of them, because they know how I am, not that I'm prideful, but I'm just, you know, I feel a certain way. Some people just give me an envelope, I'm thinking it's just an envelope to take somewhere, and it's what I need.
Amen.
Just do it in secret.
Yes.
You don't have to beat your own drum and shout out to everybody that, oh, I gave so-and-so $1,000. You ain't got to do that, because
That's
you
right.
take the glory
That's
from
right.
God.
Yeah. Yeah.
Just
yeah.
give it.
Yeah.
And if you can give it to them without them knowing who it came from, give it that way. All they know is Jesus gave it.
Amen.
He gives all the glory there.
Yes. Yes.
So I ask you guys to pray my strength in the Lord. I know I get up here and the Lord just going to talk and y'all be sleeping. But I thank y'all for this opportunity.
Amen.
And y'all be blessed.
Amen.